In this video, I'll be discussing the differences between organic and inorganic compounds. Our goal is to distinguish between these types of compounds. I need to note at the beginning of this video that it's not always so black and white, and that some compounds can toe the line between being considered to be organic by some standards and inorganic by others. The purpose of this video is to provide you with some general hallmarks of organic compounds so that you can distinguish them from inorganic compounds. Organic compounds are studied in the field of organic chemistry. This field looks at the chemistry of carbon-containing compounds, including key biomolecules such as carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids, as well as a host of other types of molecules. There are a huge number of different types of carbon compounds that can be classified by complex schemes that you'll be exposed to if you choose to take organic chemistry. Importantly, almost all of these organic compounds contain both carbon and hydrogen. Inorganic compounds are every other type of compound, generally those that do not contain both carbon and hydrogen. Carbon has unique chemistry, which is why it's the center of the field of organic chemistry. It can take on many different types of bonding patterns and arrangements. Some of those include linear molecules, such as propane, shown here, branched molecules, such as isobutane, shown here, and cyclic or ringed molecules, such as cyclohexane, shown on the right. Ethene and ethylene are two other examples of carbon and hydrogen-containing molecules that have double bonds in the case of ethene, or a double bond, and a triple bond in the case of ethylene. All five of these molecules, propane, isobutane, cyclohexane, ethene, and ethylene, contain only carbon and hydrogen. Therefore, they are classified as hydrocarbons. Acetic acid is also an organic molecule because it contains hydrogen directly bound to carbon. It also contains oxygen. There are different ways to model organic compounds, including some of the ones we've already discussed. Here's the molecular formula and structural formula of pentane. If you're drawing organic compounds that contain 6, 7, 8, 9, or more carbons, it can be a little bit tedious to draw each one as an explicit carbon. So organic chemists have developed a shortcut where each carbon is shown at either the end or the bend of this chain, and I'm shown where the carbons are in the structural formula compared to in this simplified formula. You'll notice the hydrogens are missing, and that's because of the prevalence of carbon-hydrogen bonds in organic chemistry. It's assumed that if hydrogens aren't drawn in, that enough hydrogens are there to ensure that there are four bonds to the carbon. So in the case of these end carbons, the orange and the gray, each one of those carbons is bound to one other carbon and three hydrogens. In the case of the blue, yellow, and green circles, those carbons are each bound to two other carbons as well as two hydrogens. Here's a more complex example of acetylsalicylic acid, otherwise known as aspirin. The left is a ball and stick model, the middle shows all carbons explicitly, and the right leaves out all carbons unless they're a terminal chain, such as this carbon here, which is shown explicitly at the end of this chain. Organic molecules can contain other sorts of atoms besides just hydrogen and carbon. In this case, we would call these molecules functional groups, or these molecules contain functional groups. And the reason why functional groups are important to the study of organic molecules is because molecules that contain the same types of functional groups have very similar, or can have very similar, properties. So these are just other ways that organic molecules can be characterized. Now let's practice classifying these compounds as organic or inorganic. The first compound is calcium carbonate. You'll notice it contains both a metal and a series of nonmetals. This should clue you in that this is an ionic compound. The metal is the cation, Ca2+, and the nonmetal collection is carbonate, CO3 2-. The reason why this is an inorganic molecule is that even though it contains carbon, it doesn't contain hydrogen. So therefore, we would classify this as an inorganic molecule. C4H8 is a hydrocarbon, and all hydrocarbons are organic molecules. C4H6O6 is also an organic molecule. The reason for this is because it contains both carbon and hydrogen. LiF is another ionic compound. The metal, lithium, is a cation. The anion is fluorine, the nonmetal. Because this doesn't contain either carbon or hydrogen, it has to be an inorganic molecule. Here are a few practice problems you can do on your own to classify these four molecules as either organic or inorganic based on the criteria in the video. Again, I want to highlight the point that the distinction between organic and inorganic is mainly for convenience and is not necessarily a black and white category where all molecules are strictly organic or inorganic. There is some overlap and some molecules that can be classified as both. We won't really talk about that in this class. This is more of an introduction, but I just wanted to let you know that that is possible. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.